Hello, Calvary, and to all of you who are listening in as well. We have started a series in Ephesians, as well as also 1 Peter and Acts. However, we are jumping out of all that today and jumping into Psalm 130. We'll be back in Ephesians next week, don't you worry. I just feel that Jesus has something important to say to us from Psalm 130. There haven't been many drawings being sent in recently, and maybe it's because I've been getting you to draw tricky things. Well, today's picture is easy, and I'd love for you all to draw it. So get your equipment ready, because I want you to draw one of those children's toys, which is like a block of wood with twisty, colourful, loopy metal strands coming up, crisscrossing, and then going back down into the wood. And on the twisty parts, there are jazzy beads that apparently kids find fun to push around, you know? You know what I mean. And in my experience, kids find them fun for about 5 minutes. That's all, no more. And yet they're found in pretty much every waiting room across the country, from dentists to garages. They're there, waiting for you to wait with them. And the reason why I want you to draw one of these waiting room essential starter pack toys is because the big idea of today's sermon is, oh, hold on a sec. Waiting. Waiting. As Christians, we get swept up in a frantic frenzy of all the stuff we're meant to be doing. Pray, fast, sing, serve in church, serve outside the church, tell others about Jesus, read the Bible, give money, encourage, rebuke, teach, disciple, and all the rest. It's true that these things are commanded. God tells us to do them. But there is something else God tells us to do, which gives balance and a greater sense of perspective, and that is to wait. Yes, our faith is shown in action. Being a Christian is not just clicking a mental subscribe button. It's not just about what we believe to be true. Our faith causes us to do certain things and to live in a certain way. Our faith, if it's authentic, is shown in action. But our faith is also shown through inaction, meaning not acting, i.e. waiting. You see, the Bible says the world is in a mess. It's broken. Would you agree with God on that? God says that because of humanity's broken relationship with Him, the whole of creation is frustrated. It doesn't work properly. And that's kind of what we look at, what we see in the world, isn't it? The world is in a mess. Devastation from fires and natural disasters, extreme weather, the pandemic on top of all the other diseases that run rampant, politically, economically, morally, we are in a mess. And most serious of all, spiritually, we're in a mess. And this brokenness out there resonates with all the brokenness in here. It's not just that the world is in a mess, we are in a mess. You are in a mess. Worries, doubts, addictions, grief, broken relationships, broken hearts, mental illness, physical pain. We've all got our own personal mess. Some of us hide it better than others, but we are all broken people in this broken world. We might wonder, why doesn't God do something about it? Why doesn't God sort it out? Is He blind? Does He not care? Or is He not able to sort it out? The Bible is clear that God will sort it out. Jesus will return to the earth on the day set by the Father, and when He comes again, revealed in His glorious majesty, He will judge the world in righteousness and bring final redemption to those who trust Him. There'll be no more crying or sadness or pain. There'll be no more pandemic. There'll be no more disease at all. Death will be done away with. There'll be only joy, peace, blessing. The final end of all the brokenness, there will be wholeness, there will be perfection. Jesus is coming. And yet that great day hasn't come already because God is waiting. God is waiting. Listen to this, it's 2 Peter chapter 3, verses 3 to 9. Above all, you must understand that in the last days, scoffers will come, scoffing and following their own evil desires. They will say, where is this coming He promised? Ever since our ancestors died, everything goes on as it has since the beginning of creation. But they deliberately forget that long ago, by God's word, the heavens came into being and the earth was formed out of water and by water. By these waters also the world of that time was deluged with and destroyed. By the same word and present heavens, the present heavens and earth are reserved for fire, being kept for the day of judgment and destruction of the ungodly. But do not forget this one thing, dear friends. With the Lord, a day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years are like a day. The Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some understand slowness. Instead, he is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. God is waiting. Why is he waiting? Why doesn't Jesus come back and put everything right? Because he's patiently waiting for you, if you don't yet trust Jesus. If you don't yet belong to Jesus, if you do not turn from your defiance against him and receive his gift of eternal life, you will be swept away in the judgment that's to come. Your mess won't get sorted out. You will perish. And God doesn't want that for you. He's done everything so that you don't have to have that future. Jesus died on the cross to rescue you from all of that. So put simply, God waits for you to be right with him before he puts the world right. How long has he already been waiting for you? How long has he been waiting for you to come and be forgiven? How long can you afford to keep him waiting? His offer of wholeness won't last forever. If you don't trust Jesus, I urge you, as if you're a person who was making a cup of tea in a house fire, to get out, get safe. Pray to God in Jesus' name. Turn from sin and have life. Life that starts now and will go on forever through death. The end of the world is being held up. The day of judgment is being held back so that you can share in God's eternal life. God is waiting. And for those of us who have put our trust in Jesus, we wait as well. Waiting has always been a key part of the life of the church. Abraham and Sarah had to wait 25 years for Isaac to be born after Jesus promised that he would be. Jacob had to wait 7 years for Rachel and then serve Laban another 7 years. Joseph had to wait 13 years, at least two of which were in prison, before he was exalted above his brothers as Jesus promised him. The nation of Israel waited for centuries before Jesus brought them into the land of Canaan. David had to wait about 15 years from the time he was first anointed by Samuel to the time he became king over Judah. And then it was yet another 7 years before David was anointed king over all Israel. Job was struck with tragedy and suffering. The Lord eventually restored Job's health and fortune, but he had to wait and wait some more. These are all examples to us of how God is always true to his word, but we have to wait for him. Their lives teach us the principle of waiting on the Lord, and yet, ultimately, none of them actually received what God had promised them in the fullest sense. Yes, they had little tokens to teach us, to show us, but none of them got everything that God promised them. As it says in Hebrews chapter 11, verses 29 and 30, these were all commended for their faith, yet none of them received what had been promised, since God had planned something better for us, so that only together with us would they be made perfect. That's why Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob lived in tents. They were waiting. They were all waiting. The church of the living God has always waited. Psalm 130 is a song about waiting for the Lord. Let's briefly go through it. Firstly, it's one of the songs of ascent. And what that means is it's a special song which was sung by the ancient church as they travelled to Jerusalem for the annual festivals. Even in this, we get a sense of not being there yet. These are songs for the journey. And of course, as Christ's people, we are waiting we are journeying towards our true home. Our true home isn't here in this life. Our true home is the New Jerusalem, that holy mountain garden city of God. So a song of ascent. And the psalm begins with the vivid phrase, "Out of the depths I cry to you, Lord." Now, we don't know the background of this psalm, like many of the other psalms penned by David. The author could have been troubled by enemies or suffered from physical pain. Maybe they were unable to make the journey to Jerusalem. Maybe they suffered with mental illness. It can feel like being swamped in deep waters or trapped in a pit or surrounded by gloom. Out of the depths, that kind of thing. Or the depths could refer to sin. We aren't told, which gives us the freedom to make this song our own however we relate to it, so that whatever depths we find ourselves in, we can cry out to the Lord from them, wherever we are physically, wherever we are emotionally, wherever we are spiritually. We can pray to God, we can cry out to him from the depths. Think of Jonah. He was literally on the run from Jesus in the spiritual depths, as it were, at the brink of death and at the bottom of the sea in the belly of a fish. And he prayed to the Lord, and the Lord heard his prayer, even from where he was, out of the depths. Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears be attentive to my cry for mercy. This verse 2 makes it clear that this isn't some magic mantra. This is not some self-affirming motivational speech. It's a conversation. It's reaching out to God. And we know that our God loves to hear our prayers. He loves to listen to us. The truth is, our Father is more eager to listen than we are to pray. If you, Lord, kept a record of sins, Lord, who could stand? Maybe this points to the depths, being in a spiritually bad place. And yet, whenever we truly come into the presence of the Holy One, we are always made aware of our sin. It's what Moses experienced with the burning bush. Isaiah found this when he had his awesome vision of the Lord Jesus in Isaiah chapter 6. Peter knew it too, after getting a glimpse of who Jesus truly is. And when we cry out to the Lord, for whatever reason, we will always become more aware of our sin. The fact of the matter is, the wages of sin is death. We forget that. The first sin we ever committed, Jesus would have been right to strike us down there and then. However, every day we sin. Each day we deserve death. If the Lord kept a record of our lives, if everything we did and said were written down, if he knew not just what we did, but exactly why we did everything we do, who could stand? Who would come out with a gleaming record? Who would not deserve the righteous wrath of God? The Bible says none of us would. If you kept a record of sin, who could stand? It's only Jesus. He was interrogated by man, scrutinized by Satan, and searched by God, yet in him was found no sin at all, unlike the rest of us. Let's keep reading. "But with you there is forgiveness, so that we can with reverence serve you." The incredible thing is that instead of rubbing our faces in it, like gloating over his perfect record and our shameful ones, Jesus forgives us. He has mercy on us. Jesus didn't enter this world in order to just show us up. He came to rescue us. He came to live the perfect life on our behalf, because we just can't. We can't do it. And what's more is that he's the perfect one who took the blame for our sin, all of our ugly and sinful track records. Oh, to see the pain written on your face, bearing the awesome weight of sin, every bitter thought, every evil deed crowning your blood-stained brow. This, the power of the cross. Christ became sin for us, took the blame, bore the wrath. We stand forgiven at the cross. Jesus lived in our place, died in our place, was raised to life again and went back to heaven to represent us before the Father. And he did all this to free us from being slaves to sin and to make us willing servants of the living God. And serving God and being a slave to sin couldn't be more different. Because being a slave to sin feels like death and it ends in death. Whereas being a servant of the living God is freedom, is joy-filled, it has purpose, it is eternal life, and it leads to life with our Lord forever and ever. So the psalmist here cries out to the Lord from the depths, keenly aware of their sin, and yet trusted in the Lord's grace. And then they do what? They waited. And see how they waited. With a whole being, it says. More than watchmen wait for the morning. It's like a guard waiting out in the night with all the tension and threat and danger, eagerly longing for the sun to rise. Because as the day comes, there would be hope, there would be freedom, there would be peace. During the uncertainty of the night, they cling to the certainty that the new day will come and bring peace. The church in the Old Testament looked with longing for the Messiah to come, to bring the dawn of grace to shine into their darkness. And the psalmist says, Israel, put your hope in the Lord, for with the Lord is unfailing love, and with him is full redemption. To the ancient church, the promise of the Messiah was the rock-solid foundation of their hope, knowing that the Lord's love will never let them down, never let us down either. The Lord's love will never disappoint us. Jesus Christ would come. That's what their hope was in, that Christ would come and fully redeem his people, to pay for their sin and to bring them to God, to transform their tears into joy, their mourning into dancing, their turmoil to peace. The great day was coming when Jesus, the Messiah, would come. Well, Jesus has come, hasn't he? He has died for our sin. He's redeemed us so that we belong to God. And yet, like the psalmist, we wait as well. We have been saved, but there is still a final salvation that we wait for. We have been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Praise God. And yet we wait for that final day of redemption. Therefore, let's make this song our own. As we wait, we are so used to everything being instant. We want everything now, don't we? We are impatient. We hate waiting. We find slow internet infuriating. You get stuck behind a person who walks slowly and in your head you scream at them saying, come on, sometimes not in your head. Or you're stuck behind a slow driver, whatever it may be. We hate waiting, don't we? But more seriously though, we pray for an end to this pandemic. It's been going on and on. We think, when is it all going to end? We're waiting and waiting. We may be waiting for healing. We may have the answer from the Lord saying, not yet. We are waiting for a spiritual breakthrough in the valley. We wait. The thing is, we're not guaranteed that this life will be easy following Jesus. In fact, Jesus promises the opposite. He promises that this life will be hard. God tells us to wait, though. The day is coming when peace will reign, justice will flow like rivers, and righteousness like a never-failing stream. God guarantees that it will be worth the wait. Some of you are going through a really tough time right now. And to be honest, me and the family are having a pretty tough time as well. And I've been thinking about these things. What do we do? Cry out to the Lord, don't we? We think, when is this going to end? How is this going to be resolved? Well, let all the uncertainty of now focus your heart on the certainty of what's to come. Let every struggle make you look forward to the rest you'll have. Remind yourself in your sadness, there will be indescribable joy. Just wait for it. Please send me pictures of your waiting room toys. I'd love to see them. Because we are just in the waiting room. That's what this life is. We're waiting. It's not the main event. We're waiting. No eye has seen, no ear heard, and no mind has imagined the things that God has prepared for those who love him.